for bravery. What a contrast with the Democrats. You know, I'm pretty sure the first Democratic debate consisted of Hillary and the Chipotle clerk. Well, no, actually, that's not fair. That's not fair. We can't forget about Bernie Sanders. So now, the Democratic field consists of a wild-eyed socialist with ideas that are dangerous for America and the world, and Bernie Sanders. And if you notice that they keep scheduling these Democratic debates at like 2 a.m. on a Saturday, they air them on Alaska PBS.
It's almost like they don't want anyone to watch their Democratic candidates for president. You can understand why not. But I will say we have good news. They have announced the venue for the next Democratic debate. It's going to be hosted at Lebanon. They wanted to make it easier for Hillary to attend. It's almost like the men and women of this great state have had some experience with Hillary Clinton. That's all right. We're going to rise up and we're going to save the country. Here tonight because we're bankrupting our kids and grandkids. Because our constitutional rights are under assault each and every day. And because America has receded from leadership in the world and it has made the world a much more dangerous place. And yet I'm here tonight with a word of hope and encouragement and exhortation. All across the state of Arkansas, all across this country, people are waking up. There is an awakening and there is a spirit of revival that is sweeping this country. And I am here tonight to tell you, help is on the way. Everyone here to look forward. Look forward to January 2017. If I am elected president, if and when, let me tell you what I intend to do on the first day of office. The first thing I intend to do is rescind every single illegal and unconstitutional executive action. Sadly, the corruption has not been limited to the White House. It is extended across every agency of the federal government. The second thing I intend to do on the first day of office is instruct the U.S. Department of Justice to open an investigation into Planned Parenthood. The administration of justice should be blind to party or ideology. The only fidelity at the Department of Justice should be to the laws and the Constitution of the United States. The third thing I intend to do on the first day in office is instruct the Department of Justice and the IRS and every other federal agency that the persecution of religious liberty ends today. That means that every serviceman and woman has the right to seek out and worship God Almighty with all of their hearts, minds, and souls, and their superior officer has nothing to say about it. That means that the Little Sisters of the Poor, a Catholic charity right now being persecuted by the Obama administration, will find that the case against them has been dismissed. The fourth thing I intend to do on the first day in office is rip to shreds this catastrophic Iranian nuclear deal. National security threat facing this country a lot of force to that is the threat of a nuclear Iran, and we need a commander in chief who will stand up and say unequivocally, under no circumstance will the nation of Iran, led by a theocratic Ayatollah who chants death to America, under no circumstances will the nation of Iran ever be allowed to acquire a nuclear weapon. Fifth thing I intend to do on the first day in office is begin the process of moving the American embassy in Israel to Jerusalem, the once and eternal capital of Israel. And you know, a lot of presidential candidates, both Democrats and Republicans, have made that same promise. And yet inevitably, when they get to the White House, they don't do it. You're right. Well, and the reason is their teams come to them and they say, you know, if we do this, this is going to make other folks in the Middle East really, really unhappy with us. Well, if you hadn't noticed, they're already pretty unhappy with it. And the single biggest difference between me and the other very, very fine men and women standing on that basis is that with me, when I tell you I'm going to do something, I'm going to do exactly what I said. There are 365 days in a year, 4 years in a presidential term, and 4 years in a second term. By the end of 8 years, there are going to be a whole lot of newspaper editors and reporters and journalists that have checked themselves into therapy. In the days that follow, I will go to Congress and we will repeal every word of Obamacare. We'll pass common sense health care reform that makes health insurance personal and portable and affordable and keeps government from getting in between us and our doctors. In the days that follow, I will instruct the U.S. Department of Education, which should be abolished, Department of Education, that Common Core ends today. In the days that follow, we will finally secure our borders and end sanctuary cities. There are about 360 jurisdictions in this country that declare themselves sanctuary cities. Every one of them is going to find their federal funds cut off. Which one liberal Democratic politicians value more, defying federal immigration law or keep and receiving federal taxpayer money? And we will pass peace law. We will stop releasing criminal illegal aliens, and we will end welfare benefits for those here illegal. In the days that follow, we will rebuild our military. And we will honor the commitments made to our soldiers and sailors and airmen and marines. includes reforming the VA so every veteran can choose his own doctor. And it also includes protecting the constitutional right to keep and bear arms of every service member. So the next time a jihadist walks into a recruiting center in Chattanooga, he's going to encounter the business end of firearms wielded by a dozen Marines. We will have a commander-in-chief who stands up and says to the world unequivocally, we will defeat radical Islamic terror. Willing to utter the words, radical Islamic terrorism. And we will not weaken, we will not degrade, but we will utterly destroy ISIS. Every militant on the face of the earth will understand, if you go and join ISIS, if you wage jihad against the United States of America, if you attempt to murder innocent Americans, you are signing your death. Days that follow, we will take on the EPA. And the CFPB and the alphabet soup of federal agencies that descend like locusts on small businesses, killing jobs all across this country. You know, a few years ago, I was out in West Texas, and I asked folks there, I said, what's the difference between regulators and locusts? I said, well, the thing is, you can't use pesticide on the regulators. And this old West Texas farmer, he leaned back and said, wanna bet?
And in the days that follow, I will go to Congress and we will pass fundamental tax reform. We will pass a simple flat tax. So that every American can fill out his taxes on a postcard. And when we do that, we should abolish the IRS. There are about 90,000 employees at the IRS. We need to padlock that building. Take all 90,000 and put them down on our southern border. Now, to our friends in the media, I say that somewhat tongue-in-cheek. But, you know, if you think about it, sir, if you imagine if you traveled thousands of miles in the blazing sun, you're swimming across the Rio Grande, and the first thing you see is 90,000 IRS agents. You'd turn around and go home, too. Now, some of y'all may be thinking, all of this makes sense to me. It's basic common sense. Live within your means. Don't bankrupt our kids and grandkids. Follow the Constitution. But can it be done? Can we do it? You know, Scripture tells us there's nothing new under the sun. I think where we are today is very, very much like the late 1970s. The parallels with the Jimmy Carter administration are uncanny. Same failed economic policy, same misery, stagnation, and malaise. The same feckless and naive foreign policy. In fact, the exact same countries, Russia and Iran, openly laughing at and mocking the President of the United States. Now, why is it that that analogy, again, your point is hard to argue with, but why is it that that analogy gives me so much hope and optimism? Because we know how that story ended. All across this country, millions of men and women came together and became the Reagan Revolution. And it didn't come from Washington. Washington despised Ronald Reagan. By the way, if you see a candidate who Washington embraces, run and hide. It came from the American people, and it turned this country around. We went from misery and stagnation and malaise to booming economic growth, to millions lifted out of poverty into prosperity and the American dream. We went from our hostages languishing in Iran to winning the Cold War and tearing the Berlin Wall to the ground. Why am I so optimistic? Because the same thing is happening again. All across the state of Arkansas, all across this country, people are waking up. You know, when we launched this campaign, March 23rd, at Liberty University, the New York Times promptly opined, Cruz cannot win because the Washington elites despise him. I kind of thought that was the whole point of the campaign. Listen, if you think things are going great in Washington, that we need to keep headed in the same basic direction, just kind of fiddle around the edges, then I ain't your guy. On the other hand, if you think Washington is fundamentally broken, that there is a bipartisan corruption of career politicians in both parties that get in bed with the lobbyists and special interests and grow and grow and grow government, and we need to take power out of Washington and back to we the people, that is what this campaign is all about.
So let me tell you, the state of Arkansas is going to play a critical role in this year's Republican.
Amen.
The race will start, as it always does, in Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, Nevada, those first four states. We have an amazing team on the ground in those first four states. I think we are positioned to do very, very well in those first four states. But then, 10 days after South Carolina, boom, it's Super Tuesday. It's March 1st. It's the so-called SEC primary. It's Arkansas, Georgia, Alabama, Tennessee, Oklahoma, Texas. And listen, Texas and Arkansas, we agree on just about everything. Well, except football. And I'll tell you, the role that Arkansas is going to play on that Super Tuesday is helping ensure that the next Republican nominee for president and the next president of the United States is a true and proven conservative. We're building a grassroots army here across this state and all across this country. And I want to ask every one of you here tonight to join us. Be part of that army on the ground. If you're willing to join us, I'd like to ask you to take out your cell phone and text the word liberty to the number 41444. Once again, that's the word liberty to 41444. Now, that'll do two things. Number one, it'll sign you up to be part of our team so that we can contact you and mobilize you to reach out and motivate and connect with other courageous conservatives in this great city. But secondly, it will give everyone here who does that the opportunity to contribute on your phone to our campaign. We have to date been fueled by the contributions of roughly 600,000 contributions all over the country. Our average contribution is $63. And raising the funds that y'all have been so incredibly helpful doing is how we continue to have the resources to spread across this nation our positive, optimistic, conservative message that there is a better way than the past world. Final thing I want to say is this. You know, for every one of us, freedom is not some abstract concept that we read about in school. Freedom is real. It's personal in our families. You know, for me, I think about my dad. Y'all had the opportunity to hear from my dad just a few minutes ago. My father was born in Cuba. He grew up in Cuba. And as a kid, he fought the Cuban Revolution. When he was a teenager, he was imprisoned and tortured by Batista's army. He was 17 years old, lying on the floor of Cuban jail cell, covered in mud and blood and grime. His nose was broken, his teeth were shattered out of his mouth. And he remembers thinking, I don't have any kids. Nobody depends on me. It doesn't matter if I live or I die. And yet, thankfully, God had different plans for me. He was released from that jail cell, and in 1957, my father fled Cuba and came to America. He was just 18 years old, couldn't speak a word of English, had $100 sewn into his underwear. I actually don't advise carrying money in your underwear. He got a job washing dishes, made 50 cents an hour, and he worked 7 days a week, paid his way through school, and then he and my mom started a small business together. And so I grew up in Texas. As the son of two small businesses, seeing the ups and downs, the triumphs and challenges of running a small business. Today, my father is a pastor. He travels the country preaching the gospel. Now, my whole life, my dad has been my hero. But you know what I find most extraordinary about his story? How commonplace it is. Every one of us here tonight, we have a story just like that in our backgrounds. Some of us, it's us. Others, it's our parents. Others, it's our great, great, great grandparents. But what ties all of us together as Americans is every one of us, we are the children of those who risk everything for freedom. Yeah. And that's why I'm so optimistic. Because it is the fundamental DNA of what it means to be an American to value freedom and opportunity above all else. You know, my father has said many, many times, I lost my freedom once in Cuba. I'll die before I lose it again. And that is why all of us are here. Because we are not willing to go quietly into the night. We are not willing to give up on our kids and grandkids. And I'll tell you this. Under our Constitution, sovereignty is not vested in kings and queens and principalities. It is not vested in a president. Sovereignty is vested in we the people. And if we stand together and defend freedom, if we stand together and defend the Constitution, if we stand together and defend the Judeo-Christian values upon which this nation was built, if we stand as one and come together as we the people, then we will rebuild, we will restore that last best hope for mankind, that shining city on a hill, that is the United States of America. Thank you, and God.